stand there and you sell them at the adult price, right? So you've got to somehow be able to prevent people who buy the stuff at a lower price from selling it back at the market price to people that are willing to pay more, right? So the way we do this with students, for example, is you have to show an ID, right? So you buy the ticket for Cal Performances, for example, with your student ID, and in theory, they're going to check at the door whether you have your student ID when you walk in the door, so you didn't take your $2 student discount and pass it on to somebody else, because that would be terrible. I actually think you get more than a $2 discount at Cal Performances. All right, so resales are really, really difficult or impossible resales are impossible when transactions costs are high. So, you know, if you have a house, for example, where in the transaction the cost of actually selling the house or buying the house is significant, if you're trying to resell things, each transaction eats up a lot of the value of the good, you're not going to resell stuff because the act of reselling is really, really costly, right? Also, services can't be resold. So if you've got a student discount on an Uber ride, you can't take the Uber ride and then resell that same Uber ride to somebody at a higher price, right? So resales don't happen with services, and they don't happen when transaction costs are high, and firms that price discriminate are very, very careful about making sure that your transaction costs are relatively high. Resales in general these days are relatively tough, in the sense that if you got a discount on oranges at Whole Foods and you bought your discounted oranges and then stood outside Whole Foods and you sold it at the Whole Foods market price, nobody would buy your oranges because they think there's an poison in them. Okay, so there's three types of price discrimination that we worry about. There's first, second, and third degree price discrimination. They're all different, but they all try and do the same thing in the sense that they try and discriminate by charging different consumers different prices. The first one, called perfect price discrimination, is simply actually charging each consumer exactly how much they're willing to pay. Right? So you ask each consumer, what's your exact willingness to pay? Assume they've been injected with truth serum, and they reveal their willingness to pay, and that's the price they charge for the unit. So now it's no longer the monopoly world where there's one high price, but every consumer pays a different price, and it's their true willingness to pay. Quantity discrimination is something, buy one, get the second one at half price, right? So where for the first unit you buy, you pay a different price than for the second unit you buy. And we see these all the time, right? I buy my many shirts here all the time when there's a sale on, buy one, get two free. That's pretty awesome. That's real price discrimination. I like me a free shirt. I also realize that that's rolled into the price of the first shirt, but that's a different story, right? But quantity discrimination we see all the time if there's some notion of a second price unit that you buy that has a lower price than the first unit you buy. Multi-market price discrimination is third-degree price discrimination, where you charge groups of consumers different prices. So this is the sort of student discount example I used earlier, where based on an observable characteristic of the customer, you can charge people different prices, or this could be a spatial thing too, right? Where Apple, I don't want to get sued either, but Apple charges much higher prices on their consumer electronics in Europe than they do in the U.S., right? So everything's what it costs in dollars here, that's what it costs in euros in Europe, and there's a different price in these two markets here. So you can charge across space or different groups of consumers. Okay, so let's think about perfect price discrimination. I like perfect price discrimination because it's the most sort of straightforward, intuitive way of thinking about charging consumers different prices, and it also has a really surprising outcome. So that's always exciting. Surprising outcomes. Hold on, I need my picture because I don't want to screw this one up. Okay. So this is first degree price discrimination. This is a firm that has market power, meaning it can set price within reasonable ranges. I'm going to assume that the firm can prevent resale, and I'm also going to assume that this firm is all-knowing, right? It has injected truth serum into all individuals, and they've revealed their willingness to pay. So this is already the reason why we hardly ever observe perfect price discrimination, because people have no incentive to actually tell their or reveal their true willingness to pay for the next shipment. So what this all-knowing monopoly or this all-knowing price discriminating firm is going to do is it isn't this benevolent person that's just going to charge the equal average price to all consumers, but it actually charges each individual a different price, and that price is the maximum a consumer is willing to pay for an additional unit. What does this mean now, intuitively, for consumer surplus? Well, consumer surplus is the distance between your willingness to pay, the height of the demand curve, and the price you pay. But now, this firm right here charges you your maximum willingness to pay, which is captured by the demand curve, so now price is exactly your willingness to pay. So what happens to your consumer surplus? It's gone, right? So the firm captures the entirety of the consumer surplus for each individual consumer. So if you're thinking about this now, there's no longer this average price, one price for all, but the price varies for each consumer. Hold on this way. So for the first unit, the person with the highest willingness to pay gets paid a lot, pays a lot. Second pays a little bit less. Third pays a little bit less. But at each unit is sold for the maximum willingness to pay. Hence, consumers get absolutely no consumer surplus here. This is pretty exciting. So let's check this out. Let's draw a picture. I know I'm the only person that gets really excited about this, but I'm going to show you a surprising result. Let's show the surprising result. Price, quantity, demand, marginal revenue, so 2, 4, 5. Marginal cost, I'm going to keep it simple. I'm going to draw a nice straight line here. So let's figure out a couple of prices here. Okay, the socially efficient price is this one right here. Marginal cost equals price. So this is Q star. This here is P star. That's what's socially efficient. The monopolist would charge this price and produce that quantity. That's what the monopolist, the non-price discriminating monopolist, would do. We know all this. But what's the price discriminating firm going to do? Well, for the first unit, the price discriminating firm is going to charge this price. For the second unit, this price. Third unit, that price. Fourth unit, that price. And we can just keep on going. The firm keeps on charging until the number of dollars they get is exactly equal to the marginal cost of production. So the demand curve here now is the price charge that varies across quantity. So it keeps on coming down, and they stop selling when the number of dollars they get from the last consumer is exactly equal to the cost of producing it. If they went further, then the number of dollars they would get from the consumer would be lower than the cost of producing it, so they wouldn't do it. If they stopped low of that, they could still cap it. Now, what does this mean? Where does this firm produce? I told you the surprise was the result was surprising. Where does this firm end up producing? Starts with Q, ends with star, right? This here is where this evil, price-discriminating, evil firm, they're not really evil, they're just profit-maximizing, produces, right? So that firm produces the social efficient output level. How can this possibly be? Well, let's figure it out. Consumer surplus, producer surplus, welfare. Okay, so I'm going to call this Q star, competitive or whatever. And this here, Q star, price discriminating. So let's figure out what the different levels of welfare are here. So I'm going to call this here A, this here B, this little triangle C, D, and E. So if we charge P star to everybody and produce Q star units, consumer surplus would be A, B, and C. Producer surplus would be B and D. And welfare would be A, B, C, D, E. At the price discriminating setting here, what's consumer surplus? It's the difference between price and demand over the range of production. Well, since we're charging exactly the demand for price over the range of production, consumer surplus is a big old zero. What about producer surplus? It's the difference between price producers get and the marginal cost of production right here. So this is marginal cost of production. This here is the price that now varies across consumption over the range of production. So producer surplus is A, B, and you knew it, B, C, and E. Welfare is A, B, C, D, and E. Is there a deadweight loss here? No. No. No deadweight loss. This is the efficient output level. So if we let firms price discriminate perfectly, charge everybody their exact willingness to pay, we get to the efficient output level. So economists don't have a problem with this one. Do you care about this as a consumer? That monopolist took away all of my consumer surplus and captured it. Right? So consumers hate this because consumers lose A, B, and C. Producers gain A, B, and C. And overall, there's no deadweight loss here. So this is pretty interesting. Right? Perfect price discrimination gets us to the social optimum, yet consumers lose hugely and producers gain everything. So who's trying everything in their power to price discriminate as much as they can? Producers, right? And this is actually what we see in the real world. All right, so what I'm going to show you next time is quantity price discrimination, but just as a summary right here, right? There's no deadweight loss here. We sell the socially optimal output level. The only thing that happens is that we capture all of the consumer surplus, or firms capture all of the consumer surplus. All right, next time, second and third degree price discrimination, and then I'm going to talk to you about lemons. Now, I want you to just pay attention for a minute. You got a question? All right. Yeah? Yeah? Well, there's no bargaining here. But we can talk about the bargaining price, the seller price to elicit your willingness to pay, but it's usually below the advertised price. Right here, they actually get to go above. All right. You ready for this? Pay attention. It'll just take me 479 emails. So this is the points distribution of midterm 2. Wasn't quite as good as midterm 1. Mean out of 80 points was 58.13. These lines here tell you standard deviations below the mean. This is a histogram of the distribution of grades. If you have trouble thinking in terms of out of 80, this is out of 100. The title is wrong here. So the mean out of 100 is 72.7. Again, same distribution here. We graded it. I went over a bunch of these. It looked good. If we scatter plot how people did in midterm 1 versus midterm 2, if you're roughly below the 45 degree line, you did a good job. You improved your grade. If you're above the 45 degree line, you're doing the marginal product, the low average product thing, right? Don't do that. Go in the other direction. You have 1 week as of now to ask for a regrade. Again, same thing. Put it in writing on the front page. The way I'm going to do a quiz today is really simple. If you pick up your midterm, you get a quiz grade, all right? That way we don't need to write anything down and you were here. So what we're going to do is I'm going to split this up across the three PSIs. If you want to talk to me about your midterm, please just pay attention for 5 minutes. I know you've got damage in there. If you need to talk to me about your midterm, please do so in writing, right? With questions about, you know, why did I get a point off here or feeling it. If you want to talk about general issues, I'm not doing well in the class, I'm worried about graduating, I've opted out from 2 to 4 today, come see me, right? But don't come to my office saying I'm asking for a regrade, because I will, like, do the Wolverine thing, all right? But I'm happy to talk to you about success in the grade, in the class, exam taking strategies, what can I do for the final. I will happily talk to you about anything in economics, just not about regrade. So I'm going to split this up into three piles. How about A through... There's a lot of people with a last name that begin with H. Oh, my, comes before. Hold on, this is wrong. Okay, A through G. Josh, where do you want to stand? Okay, Josh is gonna boot Sam out of that corner. H through K is Sam. Sam, where do you want to be?
I'll be over here by this.
Sam will be right over there, H through K. And then John has the rest of the alphabet.